uronic acid pathway. So it's called glucuronic acid pathway. Glucose 6-phosphate to 1-phosphate to UDP glucose to UDP glucuronate to glucuronate to glucuronate becomes ascorbate. And UDP glucuronate also will contribute to the glucuronides, proteoglycans and glycosaminoglycans wherever the glucuronate is required, which is basically called as uronic acid pathway is what need to be remembered. So it is the D-xylulose, not L-xylulose, which enters into the pentose phosphate pathway. You need to go through this literature to follow this question. Now coming to the lipids, caloric value, one of the common questions, very easy questions. Fundamentally it is carbohydrates, proteins which will yield 4 calories per gram, fats will yield 9 calories per gram, as all of you know very well. Different glycogen disorders, doctor, which will involve liver, which will involve muscle, which will involve liver plus muscle, you have to be very sure. POMS is the glycogen storage disease type 2, and it is the alpha glucosidase deficiency which you see, and that lead to interlysosomal accumulation of the glycogen, and that lead to cardiac, hepatic, skeletal muscles, all of them basically to suffer because of the POMS disease is what need to be understood. HMG-CoA reductase, what is it required for cholesterol synthesis? So the end product cholesterol will once more come back and say I am sufficiently there, and it will cause a allosteric inhibition, feedback inhibition of the HMG-CoA reductase. Coming to the palmitate synthesis, what is the typical formula which you need to remember, doctor? 7 ATPs become 7 ADPs, 14 NADPH become broken down, and during that process 8 acetyl-CoA combined to form a palmitate molecule. So this is a typical energy equation. Similarly, energy equation of citric acid cycle, glycolysis, and another peculiar question asked is, if glucose become lactate, how many ATPs? If glucose become passes through the entire citric acid cycle, how many ATPs per each glucose? There is a difference between the two, which you have to be very sure on, doctor. Okay. Now, coming to the next question. Primary biliary cirrhosis, primary sclerosing cholangitis. You must know what is the fundamental difference. Biliary cirrhosis is a middle-aged women problem, and anti-mitochondrial antibody will be found, and it will be micronodular cirrhosis, and it is relatively benign compared to sclerosing cholangitis, which is much more a troublesome problem. Those who have inflammatory bowel disease develop sclerosing cholangitis, whereas biliary cirrhosis patients are mostly asymptomatic. Only problem is jaundice, pruritus, fatigue, middle-aged women, classical of PBC, where anti-mitochondrial antibodies are typically found. Proteoglycans are the ones which will create that elastic nature of our cartilage. A 48-year-old is having history of alcoholic cirrhosis with Mallory hyaline bodies. What are they made up of? Pre-keratin intermediate filaments are the part of that hyaline which you see in the case of the alcoholic liver disease. Now coming to the carcinoma of the esophagus, unlike the other areas, the distant metastases are not frequent at the time of diagnosis. All the remaining statements are true. Squamous cell carcinomas begin as lesions in situ, and Barrett's can typically lead to risk of carcinoma. Everything is true. Now, coming to the respiratory distress syndrome. If you give too much of oxygen to the baby, what will that lead to, doctor? Typically, bronchopulmonary dysplasia is the outcome of free radical injury if you give insufflation of 100% oxygen. Ovarian cancer risk will decrease if the ovulation frequency decreases, because every ovulation there is a breach on the surface of the ovary which predisposes to the carcinogenic exposure. Contraception prevents ovulation and prevents exposure and decreases the risk of ovarian cancer is what need to be remembered. Vaginas, as I told you, vasculitis will be haunting you in the exam hall in the Prometric Center. So, vaginas, what is the classical histopathology? The large serpiginous necrotic areas with peripheral palisading macrophages is a very, very classical feature, as what you can see in this histological picture in the case of the vaginous granulomatosis. Where do you find laminar necrosis? Typically, whenever there is a global ischemia, as in a shock patient, there is a laminar necrosis because of the involvement of the short penetrating vessels originating from the pial artery suffering from hypoperfusion leads to the development of the laminar necrosis is what need to be remembered. Then coming to the alcohol abuse, it can lead to subdural hematoma, esophageal cancer, one of the causes of elevated CPK due to the myopathy, but not implicated in the primary biliary cirrhosis. What is familial hypercholesterolemia, doctor? Autosomal dominant disorder. Chromosome 19 is the one where LDL receptor gene is located, is what you have to ultimately remember. So, I think the answer is out. Question mark shaped bacteria, Leptospira, you are not going to forget. Now, in subacute combined degeneration of the spinal cord, it is the vitamin B12 dependent methylmalonic CoA mutase, which is the one which is fundamentally deficient. It is the metastasis, which is the most common tumor that involves the bone. Following that, you have many other causes. Osteogenic sarcoma, multiple myeloma, etc., etc. Then what are the common carcinomas? Lung, thyroid, breast, prostate, and you must know which are osteoblastic and clastic. Now coming to the Sjogren. When the kidney get involved in the Sjogren's, it does not lead to glomerular pathology. But will there be kidney involvement in Sjogren? Yes. Which kind of involvement? It will be a tubulo-interstitial involvement instead of a glomerular involvement. Why is this important for you, for us? Because how can Sjogren's can present dry mouth, dry eyes, exocrine deficiency, say Sjogren will present? Because the lymphocytic destruction. In addition to this, what else they will have? Sjogren's will also coexist with rheumatoid arthritis, right? Now, rheumatoid arthritis or SLE, any of them, if they are responsible for kidney involvement, they will involve glomeruli. But if the kidney involvement is not because of the associated rheumatoid or associated SLE, but because of the Sjogren, it won't involve glomerulus, it will involve tubulo interstitium. Okay, sir, another 50 days exam is there. Why all these things? You think glomerulus is there, interstitium is there. To kya hai? There is an earth and sky difference in the patient's life, let me tell you. What is the treatment of Sjogren? I mean, what is the treatment of glomerular, renal involvement in autoimmune renal pathologies? We give immunosuppressive therapy. Immunosuppressive therapy. If it were to be tubulo interstitial pathology predominantly, then it will respond very well to your immunosuppression, unlike the glomerular pathology. So that is the reason whenever a patient of Sjogren has a renal involvement, why you need to do renal biopsy to know whether it is due to glomerular involvement because Sjogren can coexist with SLE or rheumatoid arthritis, or whether it is tubular interstitial. If it is tubular interstitial, prognosis is good. That's the reason, for the patient's sake. So renal glomerular lesions are uncommon. All the remaining things are very much true. Now what is the distinguishing feature between Crohn and ulcerative colitis? All of you are experts now. Fistula, transmural involvement, they're all the features of Crohn's. Purely mucosal is ulcerative colitis. Cobblestoning is Crohn's. Then pseudopolyp formation. There should not be a division of thought. If we have still a division of thought about inflammatory bowel disease differences, still 40 days time is there, because they are the topics where absolute knowledge, doctor. If you are Shankaracharya, if you don't know Vedas, nobody will agree you. So if you are a PG, neat PG aspirant, and if you don't know the differences, still some confusion is there. Cobblestone here or there, shall I put fistula here or there, then you will be clean bowled in the face bowling of exam. So Crohn's is fistula is what need to be remembered. Then granulomas does not always rule out Crohn's. Absence of granulomas does not always rule out, though the granulomas are classical of Crohn's disease. Crohn skips ulcerative colitis and etc. I leave all this literature for you, doctor, for you to review.